What I would do today is I'm shooting this video from TAP 216 in Murray, Kentucky. The owner was gracious enough to let me have a nice place where I could sit and talk to everyone this afternoon. So I'm going to post this impromptu introduction and lecture for you guys to enjoy in your spare time. So let me introduce myself, because most of you probably don't know who I am. I've communicated with a few of you via email, but I really haven't done an introduction yet. So I just want to let you know my name is Michael Busby, and I've been working in GIS and teaching GIS since about 1991. I started my career in Overland Park, Kansas, working as a intern. And then I became a planning technician 1, and then eventually became a 3. And then I decided I needed to go to graduate school and came to Murray State, because at that point in time they had a great graduate program. They used Unix boxes, IBM computers that ran Unix, a particular kind of Unix called AIX. AIX, the letters. And so we were using Sun Microsystems at Overland Park, Kansas, to do our GIS work. And so the languages are similar. They used Sun Microsystems used an operating system called Solaris, and it was very similar to the AIX in Murray State's IBM environment. So the transition was actually pretty easy for me, because most of the computers at that point in time were all Microsoft Windows DOS machines, a few 3.1 machines. That was before Windows 95 came out. It was basically back in the days of 286s, 386s, and maybe if you're lucky, you had a 486. And some of you probably don't even know what the hell I'm talking about. But yeah, so it goes back a little ways. Stay here at Murray State, I've been here since 1993, so this is my 27th year. While working at Murray State, I've worked on a bunch of different projects. I've forgotten about some of them, but I've worked for the U.S. Forest Service, I've worked for the U.S. Fish and Wildlife, I've worked for the Division of Water. When I did my master's degree, the West Kentucky Corporation, which does not exist anymore, paid for my school. And the reason they paid for it was because I did work for them. I analyzed and studied and researched unemployment, and specifically not just any unemployment. I looked at the number of people available to work, which is a different number than unemployment. It's really interesting, and it really brought a lot of things together, particularly when you're looking into economic development. And so I really do like economic development and all the aspects and details associated with that, which led me into some work I did for Connect Kentucky, which expanded its services and its mission, and is now known as Connected Nation, actually. So if you do a Google search for Connected Nation, Connected Nation started at Western. That's where their home office was located. Some of the technical services were developed here at Murray State. Specifically, I had to help them develop some technical services, particularly when it comes to mapping broadband access. So I've done a lot of broadband access. I've broadband mapping and mapping of broadband access since 2003, probably. I've also done work for Kentucky Emergency Management Services. I've done work for Tyson. That's just to name a few, just to kind of give you an idea of exposure. A few years ago, I did some contract work for the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers and the National Guard. The National Guard gets called out for emergencies, when emergencies happen, like flooding and or earthquakes. And so I have done work for them as well, too. So the nice thing about working at Murray State is it's allowed me to work on a lot of different projects. I didn't even touch on the archaeology projects I've worked on over the years. But that's the great thing about geography. Geography exposes you to a bunch of different topics, And then working in a university environment, not only do you get to work on these topics, but you also get to work on the experts who are associated with those topics. I've had a really good working relationship with biology, with the business program, the economic development, the Small Business Development Center. I've done work for the Chamber of Commerce in Callaway. And so universities, everybody kind of runs down the idea of, oh, why do I need a college education? You know what? College education exposes you to a bunch of different ideas, a bunch of different people from a bunch of different backgrounds that you would never run across if you just went off and did either no education or did a technical degree. Because universities are a hub for smart people and smart ideas and innovation. And, you know, while you may not sit there, you know, while you may sit in the classroom and you may ask yourself, why do I have to have this class? You know, you can meet somebody in this class who has a great idea, or meet other people in your class, or connect with your instructor who has a good idea. But it is about networking. So one of the things I like to point out too is you have to be actively involved in your own education. And what I mean by that is you can sit there in a class and have a bad attitude about why you're in there. But what I would do is kind of flip the tables and ask yourself, well, you know, if I had to teach this class, how would I teach it? How would I break up the material? How would I present the material? What would I do different than what this person, what this professor is saying? And, you know, it takes a minute because not everybody has those ideas because we're so pissed off that we've got to take an art history course, or we're so upset we got to take this course that doesn't really have anything to do with our major. But you can learn some of the best classes you may have are the classes that aren't with your major, but because the instructor presented the material in such a way that it made the class worthwhile. So I ask you, what traits does that person communicate? What traits does that person exhibit that makes that class worthwhile? Because those are the things you can take away from a course that may have nothing to do with your major. Some classes in your major are going to be horrific. They're just going to be horrid. And you might leave the course thinking, oh, this could have been the best course ever if they had just done blah, blah, blah. Well, one thing you need to think about is you might be in a state where you decide you want to get a master's degree or you want to work on a PhD, and then you'll end up being that person in front of a class. So put yourself in those shoes. Get out of your student shoes for a minute, because you're a human being. And just because you're a student doesn't mean you're not a human being. It just means you have a lack of experience and a lack of knowledge. But you can put yourself, you can do a conduct a thought experiment and put yourself in the role of the person leading the class and ask yourself, you know, how would I do this differently? How could I do it better? How could I improve upon things? So be an active participant in your own education. And this goes for, you know, it doesn't have to be for college class, because when you get out of college and you have to move on to a different environment and you have to take workshops or seminars or something, you'll still be in a place where you're going to be sitting across a table from somebody who's leading a lecture or leading a discussion or showing, you know, a software demonstration. And you're still going to want to be an active participant in that particular role as well, too. And so that's what I'm encouraging you to do. Sometimes it's hard because we have a bad day, our dogs bite us in the middle of the night, you know, we don't feel good because we have allergies. So sometimes it's hard for us to get over that hurdle. But in a general sense, be an active participant in your own educational thought processes. As a different note, besides being a lecturer at Murray State, I'm also the GIS coordinator for Murray State. I'm working through the Mapping Applications and Resource Center, which is located on the top floor of Blackburn. I'm the ESRI representative for campus, so I don't have to sign the contract or anything like that, but I am the point of contact for our software, for licensing, for student accounts, for ArcGIS Online, for technical support. for general and specific questions regarding the use of the software. So that's my other role. So I'm half faculty, half professor, and I'm half education technology administration. There's not really a real title for it. So basically I look at it as I'm the GIS coordinator for Murray State, and my kind of generic role is education technology. I also teach world geography. Some of you may have had me in GSC or EES 110. I teach weather and climate once in a while, and I also teach cartography, which is a great course too. My office is on the third floor of Blackburn Science Building. It's in room 306A, in case anybody needs help installing software or GIS advice or whatnot, you are welcome to come see me. The best way to reach me is via email. I try to check those every day, at least a couple times a day. I stop checking them about 5 o'clock on Friday, and sometimes it's hit or miss over the weekend because I try to lock that time away for myself. But you know, it is what it is sometimes. And sometimes I'll email, sometimes I will check emails on the weekend. So this is our book. Let me show you our book. This is actually a really good book. GIS Fundamentals, the First Text on Geographic Information Systems, it's the 5th edition, Paul Volstead. It's a very generic book, so that's one reason why I like it. I'm going to begin with the introduction, chapter 1, that begins on page 1. And I'm going to deviate from one of the examples in the book. The book spends a lot of time talking about natural resources. And GIS really took off because it was used for mapping natural resources. Minnesota and Wisconsin were highly invested in developing software and a means to map and manage natural resources. So it sort of has its roots in natural resources. But that doesn't mean that's where we're locked into, clearly. As I stated earlier, geography is really great for a lot of reasons. It presents a lot of opportunities to work with a lot of different topics, a lot of different disciplines. It's a holistic field. GIS is a holistic field that brings a lot of different people together with a lot of different experiences and the background of knowledge. But the way I kind of look at this, and it's kind of weird, is GIS is sort of it's kind of like accounting for geography. So, and what I mean by that is basically I look at accounting, and accounting is really concerned with numbers and making sure those numbers are congruent, making sure those numbers make sense, making sure everything is precise down to the penny. Making sure accounts, so we have all these accounts and things and they all have to balance, and we do, you know, sometimes when they don't balance, we have to go through and kind of do some forensics on them to figure out why they don't balance. And GIS kind of takes that to another level because now we have a spatial component and a time component. And so we're basically doing some accounting of our world. We're going through and cataloging and assessing and evaluating and creating this massive inventory of all the things in our physical space, and then we're putting that into a visual database. Everything around us is associated with geography. So when you, like, I'm sitting here at the patio on tap looking out across at Pogue Library on the campus of Murray State, and all I see around me is things that are associated with geography. You know, for example, I see Toyotas, and I see a Honda, and I see two Hondas, and I see a Chevy, I see three Hondas, I see four Hondas, I see a Jeep. You know, okay, so all of those vehicles are made with parts that may or may not be made within the United States, right? So everybody knows when you buy a car that most of those parts are, some of them come from the United States, but some of them come from elsewhere. Hondas, which is Japanese, I believe. I know Toyotas are. You know, those headquarters are overseas, but those cars are made here using American labor, and some of them use American parts. Some of the parts come from Mexico and come from around the world. So, but those parts are all managed and those parts are all mapped. That's why there's always a code on a part, is because that part has a unique address. So when that part leaves the plant, the plant that produces that part knows where that part goes. Up until the point that it's sold to you, and then it may not, then it may lose track, or once it leaves the Advanced Auto Parts or O'Reilly Auto Parts, it may lose track of where it is. But it's hard to continue to do those things over that period of time. But still, those parts are all mapped. When I have a bunch of friends that work at Pella, all the parts they use at Pella all have either Rifid tags on them or they have barcodes on them, and not only do they know how many they have in stock, because every time that they assemble something, that barcode gets scanned to know that it's been used. But they also know, they know where it is in time, and they know where it is in space, because it's attached to a workstation, and that workstation has a coordinate attached to it, and has an XY coordinate attached to it, and they know where that plant is. And so they know where those bits and pieces of all those windows assemblies are going, because they're all being mapped. Maybe not in real time, but they're all being mapped at some point. Now, I think at some point I made a little bit, some notes about using Kodak, COVID-19, and contact tracing. I'm going to take a drink because my mouth is dry. Burrito Shack also makes good burritos and good breakfast too, in case anybody's interested. They're not paying me for that. I'm just throwing it out there. COVID-19 presents a lot of amazing amount of data, and I might set up a, I might post a video that I made in the spring to help my cartography class get through things, because there's so much data, and this class is about mapping data. This class is about taking information, converting that information to data, storing the information in a place, and then using that information essentially to make some maps. I mean, that's the bottom line. Everybody wants to see a pretty map. But it's also much deeper than that, too, because you can get into a lot of sophisticated spatial analysis, too. So, one of the reasons why I wanted to sit here at TAP was because one of my favorite shows a few years ago was a show called Bar Rescue. And John Taffer, it used to be the president of, I believe, like the Bartenders Association of America. And during the show, he would go through and evaluate a bar or a restaurant. And towards the middle of the show, he would sit down with the owners and lay out a huge map. And I was like, wow, this is fascinating. Because one of the things that he was doing on the map is he would go through with a pen. I need to have my prop. He would go through, and he would start marking places, and he would say, okay, here's your bar. All right, so I've had my business consultants go through and analyze your network or your neighborhood. And he's like, your bar is trying to cater towards a crowd that's 21 to 35 years old. Which is great, because they might have some money, but everybody around your bar, based on the census information, they're all up 45 to 60. So you might want to consider redesigning your bar or changing the appeal of your bar to match the clientele of your neighborhood. And so that's a geographic question, because demographics is part of geography. The census is a fundamental part of data collection for all the things that we do. Like that book points out on page three, it says GIS are at the heart of one of the most important processes in U.S. democracy. The constitutionally mandated reshaping of congressional districts, and hence the distribution of tax dollars and other government resources. So they're talking about the U.S. Census. We have to have the census, and it has to remain, I'm going to be a little bit political, it has to remain unperturbed and undisturbed from political influence and processes. Let the people do their job and collect their data. don't put any, don't mess around with it, because once you start messing around with it, you taint the data. And so if they decide to do what they're going to do and put questions on there or remove questions, then the data always has to have an asterisk after it. And it's pretty much, it's really biased, and it's almost garbage. Because now you really don't know how many people you have. You really don't know what kind of socioeconomic background that they're from, culturally what they're from. And it's just, it just taints the whole process. And how do you make good decisions without having good data? Once you start tainting stuff and start showing bias one way or the other, and bias is you can have positive bias or negative bias. So bias is just a leaning. It doesn't tell you which direction it is. But once you start messing with the collection of the data, then, you know, and you're changing from the previous processes, you know, in a negative way, you know, it's always better to collect more data because you can always filter it. But if you don't collect data, then that's garbage. Then you end up having, you know, you just have to make stuff up, and that's not good. Or if you know that there's a political bias or a political slant towards asking certain things, that's going to affect the veracity of the questionnaire, or even if somebody answers it or not, even though you're supposed to, that's a problem. I mean, that is a huge problem. So how do you make good decisions? How do you make good data-driven scientific decisions without having good data? Emotion, essentially. I think that's the answer. So anyway, so I'm sitting here at Tap 216, which is a restaurant bar that's been here for, it's been under management by a family for a couple years. I think they're entering into their third year. And so they cater basically towards a college crowd, an educated crowd, the crowd that is like the management, mid-management, upper-level management for a lot of the area businesses. They keep the establishment clean, well-managed, professional, because they have an appeal that they're trying to get to, because is basically a college-based community. I mean, let's face it, Murray State has, we've got an enrollment of around 8,500 students right now. Usually it hovers around 10, but COVID has kept some people away. Murray State also has a hospital. It also has a couple of major manufacturing facilities. One of them is Pella. We have a hospital, another area hospital. We have Murray Calhoun County Hospital, and then we have Jackson Purchase Medical Center. People are very interested in doing economic development around here, and so when you're looking to bring people in, to locate a business, to locate an industry, to have a commercial site, do commercial development, or to put a restaurant in, a coffee shop, like we just had a Starbucks open. Starbucks has a GIS. They have GIS people that helps them plan their store locations, believe it or not. They analyze the demographics of their market. If you want to know why there's no Target in Murray, it's because we don't have the population density in western Kentucky to support a Target. Not like they do in Clarksville, and I think Carbondale has a Target. But many of these companies like Target, like Walmart, like Starbucks, Chick-fil-A, Steak and Shake, they have thresholds. They have demographic thresholds which they look for, and if your area doesn't meet those demographic thresholds, they're not going to be there. I've done work for so many different companies. Some of them I don't know, because I did them through the Chamber of Commerce, and the Chamber would basically say, hey, there's a major company that's looking at the area. I need to know how many households are within a 50-mile radius. I need to know how many households are within a 75-mile radius. I need to know what the unemployment rate, or how many people are unemployed within a 50-mile radius, or how many people are unemployed in a 100-mile radius. And so I figured out what those numbers are, and then hand them to the Chamber of Commerce, and then the Chamber puts a packet together so they can distribute those to companies and corporations and restaurants and whatever to see if if the threshold is met. And a lot of times a threshold is not met for Western Kentucky because our population density is so low. Sometimes it's not just a simple issue of population density, but sometimes it's a question of the age group. Some companies want an older group, some companies want a younger group. It can be a threshold of household income, not individual income, but it can be an issue of household income. In the terms of manufacturing, some manufacturers need to have a large unemployment. A sizable unemployed workforce because they know they're going to have turnover. If you don't have enough people in the area that are willing to work, you're not going to get manufacturing to move in. And they also, that seems weird, but the reality is not everybody's going to want the job. Like Pella, for example. Pella is a hard job to work. It's a physically demanding job. Sometimes they work you for 56 hours a week or more. And they have a fairly high turnover rate. So if you know you're in your manufacturing sector that you have a high turnover rate, then you need to have a large pool of people ready to work or wanting to work or looking for work. If your pool is too small, then pretty soon everybody who wants to work has already been in your place and won't come back. And so now you're out of luck because you've used up your pool of unemployed people. And that's sometimes what happens around here is, we can have a 10% unemployment, but if you've only got 150 people in your county, that's 150 people. And that's not enough people for a company that, even if they had, say they had 75 manufacturing jobs, you're gonna run through your labor pool in a year if you have 100% turnover. So, there's a lot of factors that go into this, but this is one of the powerful tools where GIS comes into play, is helping make these kind of decisions. Whether it's COVID or Tap 216 or a Burrito Shack, a place like Burrito Shack probably doesn't need to do a lot of demographic mapping because everybody goes in there and has food. They have a finite product. They have a specific geographic location. Burritos appeal to a wide audience. He's located in a college town, and even though the parking over here is kind of garbage, he still thrives. GIS, in simple terms, is about creating a database to keep track of something that's interesting to us. This something of interest to us has some sort of geometry associated with it. That we can use, some type of geometry that we can use to represent this something. Now, I have put the argument out that everything is geography, and geography is everything. I can take anything that you give me and make a geographic argument out of it. And so, the common example that I use is, let's say Buddhism. How do you map Buddhism? Well, you look at the number of people. Yeah, that's why the census is important, because that's one of the questions on there is a religious affiliation. How many people apply to Buddhist principles? And you can figure those things out. Usually you don't do it by person, but what you can do is look at it by census tract or look at it by county, right? So you can look at the prevalence of Buddhism by looking at county data and look to see how many people within that county identify as Buddhist or identify as following Buddhist principles. So even though Buddhism is kind of an ideology, we can use the physical manifestation of that is the person. The person lives in a place, and then we tie that person to the place that they live. The geometry then becomes the census tract. The geometry, if it's not the census tract, then it becomes the county. So that's where everything can be tied back to some type of geography, sometimes geometry. Points, lines, and polygons represent things in our real world, and we use those that geometry, the points that make up the line, the points that make up the polygon, or the point. We can use those within a database And then we tie what's called attributes, which are the traits that those things have, into that database, right? So, like, for example, I'm sitting across from Pogue. Murray State Facilities Management has lots of computer assisted drafting, a lot of CAD files, computer assisted design files that have all the building footprints on campus. So, you know, I could use the building footprint, the CAD file, for the Pogue library and use that as the basis for a map of Pogue. Because that's geometry. And then I could go through and say, okay, let's see how many books are in Pogue, or how many, what's the square footage of Pogue, or come up with some type of trait or characteristic associated with Pogue library, attach that into the database with the geometry, and that's basically what GIS is you're using a point, a line, or a polygon, some type of simple geometry, and then you're tying an attribute to it. So that's part of it, right? But it's not all of it. So a GIS, remember what we're talking about here. We're talking about geographic or geography, or if you're British or European, sometimes they refer to it as geographical. But it's a geographic information system. So it's an information system that's connected to geography. So it's a special kind of information system. That's why when you're out there getting a job and you get hired to be a GIS technician, that you find yourself doing information systems work as well too. So just be forewarned. So typically a GIS has five primary components. It has at least these five. It can have more, but it usually has these five. You have to have a computer. You don't have to have a printer, but you have to have a computer. You have to have software. You have to have a person that knows how to run it. Usually, you're going to have some type of techniques or analysis or a method to evaluate your data once you have it pushed into your database, right? Then, you also have to have your data, because without your data, you don't have anything but a computer and a person sitting in front of there, and you can, you know, play Animal Crossing or No Man's Sky or Call of Duty, and you know, but that's not GIS. But those are built upon GISs, interestingly enough. So you can have other aspects. But those are the primary five. You have a computer, you have software, you have yourself, your technician, your analyst, your manager. You have your methods, which are the algorithms and techniques and stuff like that that are used to go through and, you know, spatially massage your data. And then you also have to have a data, because that's all this is built around. There's other things. So we can talk about documentation. That's not really in here,